Rabbi Abarbanel is so fantastically heroic and important. I mean, I wish I could spend so much more time researching his life and his activity. I'm deeply inspired by it. You'll see, here it is. Our sponsor tonight is Mr. Charles Joseph, who has been a long-time sponsor of these classes in various forms. He was also a sponsor of my most recent book, which I deeply appreciate, which he dedicated to his beloved parents. Tonight's source is going to rely very heavily on the research of a man named Benzion Netanyahu, born in Warsaw at the beginning of the century. Ironically, it's the same birth date as my grandmother, Aleha Shalom. So I guess this is how old she would have been. And he passed away in Jerusalem just a few years ago. He was a professor. He became interested in Sephardic studies, a professor at the University of Denver, then at Cornell University. I actually briefly had an office near his office when I was there as a postdoctoral fellow. Later, the Encyclopedia of the Encyclopedia Hebraica. But the reason why we're studying him tonight, of course, is because he wrote a definitive biography of Abravanel. Abarbanel. We'll get to that name in a second. Which was published originally in 1953 and then reissued three times afterwards because it was really so classic. You may recognize the name Netanyahu because here he is with his illustrious son Benjamin, the current Prime Minister of Israel. He was also the father of Yoni Netanyahu, the hero of Entebbe, and really a very impressive individual. Another son also involved in the IDF. So he has a political and a religious history that's fascinating, but for our purposes, it's his work as a historian that will inform most of our comments tonight. Okay, so I want to go back to something that we spoke about briefly when we looked at the life of Abraham Senior last week. And I alluded to this idea that when I first read the work of Raoul Hilberg, I really thought that the whole connection to the Spanish Inquisition and the Holocaust was a stretch. When I read Benzion Netanyahu's work, though, I see that it's quite possible when you look at the dates that Hilberg, who was not an expert in Sephardic history, was probably heavily influenced by Netanyahu's work, because that's where you see the thesis developed in a much more precise fashion. And I think we can look at this in the sense that there's, I'm sure you've heard the famous passage from Santayana, which is, those who ignore history are doomed to repeat it. And in our, here at Touro College, our the chair of our history department, Toba Singer, likes to say to students, those who forget history are doomed to repeat it next semester, right? Because they have to take it again. So there's another quip that says, well, history may not repeat itself, but it certainly rhymes. And there's an eerie rhyme going on here. So let's look for a second at some basic elements of Netanyahu's breakdown of the onset of the Inquisition and the expulsion, and I think we have some eerie parallels. This is a 17th century rendition of an auto da fe, a mass execution, burning at the stake as a result of inquisitorial activities. So if we look at this pattern that we discussed last week, it really starts out in the late 14th century when you have these mass conversions of Jews. Netanyahu tends to take a very economic approach to the reasoning behind these mass conversions. Much of the anti-Jewish legislation, he argues, or activity, like, you know, rioting and so on, he argues came primarily from the burgher class, meaning not the nobility and not the peasantry, but the urban class, a burgeoning commercial class that saw the Jews as direct competitors in their various fields of endeavor. And so it was they who really fomented much of this activity. Ironically, Netanyahu argues, they were unprepared for the results, because the ongoing trope in the relationship between Christianity and Judaism has been, you know, Jews were given the option of convert or die. And as we saw in the Ashkenazic lands in the Crusades, quite often they chose simply to die in some cases even to commit suicide. On other occasions, which makes it a little bit more complicated than just the binary choice of convert or die, there are two other choices. One is, or pay us lots of money to leave you alone. And the fourth choice is, or run away, flee. So the burghers were expecting perhaps one of those options. They were not, according to Netanyahu, expecting the fact that Jews might say, okay, let's convert. Which is, in fact, what happened in 1391, is that the Jews kind of unexpectedly and en masse decided to accept Christianity, which is not something that you see as a pattern in much of European Jewish history. The reasons why it differed in the 14th century are beyond the scope of our inquiry today. Netanyahu would argue, though, it was primarily for social mobility, meaning that the Sephardic Jews felt, you know, this is a really terrible situation. We would rather much prefer to remain Jews and remain in our sphere of activity and have our commercial privileges ratified. But if we're given the choice, perhaps we should pro forma convert and maintain our business practices as always. And then when things calm down, we will go back to Jewish identities. And the burghers, argues Netanyahu, were caught off guard by this. And of course, it was a disastrously counterproductive strategy, because once the Jews converted, the Christian state had no legal mechanism to discriminate against them. And all of a sudden, all of their restrictions on commerce, on settlement, on education, on advancement in the professions, on entry into guilds, were all disappeared in an instant. And so they were confronted with perhaps 100,000 new competitors who had the same legal rights that they did. Hence, this caused the persecution of these so-called new Christians, where the Christian state now had to actually create a new category that did not exist in Christian theology, these almost Christians. They had performed the rites of baptism, and by all traditional canon law, they were in fact full Christians. What is a new Christian? So new Christians and their children and their grandchildren were kind of like really suspect Christians. We're not exactly sure what to do with them. This led to the Inquisition, because the church was interested in, well, what are we doing with all these people who claim to be Christians and they're not really practicing and they're going back to their Jewish roots? So you had to inquire as to their bona fides, quite literally. And the Inquisition led, as we discussed last week, to the isolation of the Jewish community, because the Jews who had converted were still in extensive relationships with their erstwhile co-religionists, and this ultimately and inevitably led to the expulsion. This is the kind of flow of history that we discussed last week, Netanyahu's thesis. There are others who disagree, particularly with the economic component of this analysis, but it sounds remarkably familiar. Because if you look at the late 19th century and early 20th century of Germany, we see, let's put up the Spanish pattern over here on the left, we see almost identical things happening in Germany. This is the rhyme of history, perhaps. Late 19th century and the 20th century, you have a massive number of Jews converting to Christianity. Again, purely pro forma, as a means to gain entry to all of the avenues of social advancement that were closed to them. And we could rattle off a dozen names of prominent individuals in the 19th century in all fields of endeavor who were Jews who chose Christianity for those reasons. Some, like Heinrich Heine, regretted it and described it as baptism was their ticket to European culture, but nevertheless felt badly about it for the rest of their lives. Not our point. It allowed for tremendous social mobility, where you had all of these Jews who were, you know, reaching the tops of their professions and intermarrying extensively with Germans. And this created an environment that, not religiously, but socially, was untenable, because the Aryans, so to speak, felt themselves excluded from their own country, that there was this kind of like separate class of people who are like the in crowd, who were Jews with a tremendous amount of power in the media, in banking, arts and culture and so on. This leads under the Nazi period to an isolation of the Jewish community, passing of restrictive legislation to try and identify those Germans who are non-Aryan and separating them away from the rest of the population, ultimately leading to expulsion. And when, and obviously that could not be wholesale in Germany because they still had the rule of law that they had to deal with, but ultimately found its expression in the Holocaust. So this rhyme of history, this linkage of the Spanish Inquisition and expulsion to the 20th century Holocaust, I think actually has a tremendous amount of theoretical appeal, and it's the kind of resonance that we have to be aware of, even if in our own days. Okay, but let us concentrate on our main topic today, which is, of course, Don Yitzchak Abravanel. We should begin with, how do we say his name? Netanyahu actually catalogs 17 highly distinct spellings of his name in the Latin alphabet. Of course, he was active in Spain, Portugal, Italy, and as a result, using the Latin alphabet, you have a lot of different variations, and 9 different spellings in Hebrew. And Hebrew, of course, does not conventionally include vowels in its written or printed writings, and so it gets even worse. How exactly do you pronounce it? One of the most popular versions in America is Abarbanel, and when I told my wife I was giving a lecture on Abravanel, she said, who? And I said, Abarbanel, oh, like the wine, right? Because that's how she remembers it that way. Abarbanel is perhaps, if you go to a yeshiva, they'll say Abarbanel. There's a popular song, Abarbanel. Ba ba ba, Abarbanel. You've heard it. But the probably correct, I'm following Netanyahu here, probably correct is Abravanel. That's probably how he pronounced it, more or less, with my Canadian accent. His years are 1437 to 1508. He came from an extremely illustrious family. Many communal leaders in his lineage, fathers, grandfathers, great-grandfathers, all with tremendous wealth and prestige, honor, leaders of the community. His family originates in Spain in the city of Seville, which ironically was one of the epicenters of the anti-Jewish activity in the 14th century. And in fact, very tragically, his own grandfather Shmuel converted to Christianity. We don't know enough about the details, but most likely in the wake of those initial pogroms of 1391. Several years later, however, Shmuel brought the entire family over to Portugal, which had a decidedly more pro-Jewish or at least tolerant approach. And there in Portugal, safe from the Inquisition, he abandoned Christianity and returned to Jewish life. Abravanel rarely refers to his grandfather's conversion. It seems to have been something of a blight on the family history, so you only find out about it from sources outside of his own writings. He received in Lisbon, where he was born, a traditional Jewish Sephardic education. And we'll look at what those things are momentarily. But first, let us understand a little bit about, you know, why was Portugal so friendly to Jews when just across the border you had one of the most intense periods of anti-Jewish persecution in memory. One of the reasons is because the Spanish kings were moving rapidly towards the absolute monarchies that were modeled in, let's say, France and to some degree Germany, some degree Russia, where the kings had far more absolute power. That was not at all the case in Portugal, where there was still quite a bit of division of power. And one of the areas where the king did have significant power and could wield it over the church was the institution of servi camerae. You may recall we discussed this very briefly last week. That's basically, the term is Latin and it means servants of the chamber, meaning the royal chamber, an institution in which Jews reported directly and exclusively to the king. They did not report to local nobles. They certainly didn't report to burghers. And so as a community, whatever revenues they generated through tax farming or commerce or whatever could be taxed solely by the king directly. As a result, the Jews were an extremely valuable institution because the king could deploy them specifically to fill his own coffers. The burghers were the principal, according to Netanyahu, the principal opponents of the Jews, but the king, who had sufficient power there, who could allow this against the power of the church, which was weaker in Portugal, was very happy to bring these conversos into Portugal and was perfectly okay with allowing them to return to Judaism. We won't actually talk about it today, but 5 years after the Spanish expulsion, here I am not talking about it today, 5 years after the Spanish expulsion, when Portugal wanted to enter into a dynastic union with Spain, unifying the peninsula, the rulers reluctantly imposed the expulsion on Jews, but with kind of a wink and a nod, they said, but if you convert to Christianity, we will give you a 20-year lease on the Inquisition. In other words, just convert to Christianity, just do the thing with the water, all right? And for 20 years, we're going to look the other way on Pesach and when you kosher your house for, you know, and koshering your meat and things like that. We'll look the other way for 20 years, hoping to keep the Jews in the population rather than having them leave. Of course, they left. Still, this was a period of tremendous change. Abravanel was right at the center of it. But in his early years, it was actually a very stable kingdom with tremendous opportunities for growth and advancement for a well-placed and rather brilliant young man like Abravanel. He was especially associated with one of the more powerful houses of the nobility, the House of Braganza. This is the Alfonso the he became Alfonso I, the Duke of Braganza. His initial association with Braganza would be excellent for his advancement. Later on, however, it would prove to be his demise, as we shall see. What was his traditional education? So he received a thorough grounding in rabbinics. And if there was a bias toward one aspect of the massive oeuvre of the rabbis, it would certainly be studies of Tanakh. He was an unparalleled expert in the Hebrew scriptures, and of course much of his writings are based on the Hebrew scriptures. One of the Spanish, we haven't had enough time to discuss these things this semester, but one of the Spanish geniuses of their particular form of Judaic research was into text, and specifically Tanakh. So the Spaniards excelled in perfecting the Talmudic text and also the religious texts. Spain was also, of course, a hotbed of Kabbalistic activity, people like the Ramban, Moshe de Leon, and others, and so he was quite familiar with Kabbalistic texts. This would be very significant later on in his life as he began to write about Messianism and predict a Messianic future. He believed, for example, that 1503 was going to be the year that Mashiach came. He was quite disappointed to live past that date without Mashiach. At the same time, again in a typically Sephardic mode, he received a very extensive and thorough education in secular studies. Rhetoric was a big deal. He studied Cicero, Thucydides, many of the great Latin classics in particular, and he even studied the church fathers, who are also noted for their rigorous dialectic and their beauty of expression in Latin, which he knew quite well. He was heavily influenced by Aristotle, although he had significant differences with Maimonides, and one of his great works was a commentary on Maimonides. Later, through the influence of his son, he began to shift himself a little bit more towards the Neoplatonics, but nevertheless, we're talking about a person who is truly a gifted and well-rounded individual with a tremendous breadth of sources at his fingertips. In fact, he's one of the more popular of the Hebrew commentators on the Bible in the church, primarily because of his very liberal attitudes towards deriving arguments from sources outside of the Judaic tradition per se. Okay, so in Portugal, he rose along a trajectory that you might anticipate for a person of this stature with the background that he had and the experience of his fathers and forefathers. He rose to become the leader of Portuguese Jewry under Alfonso V in his 30s, and he performed a number of economic activities, tax farming, just like Abraham Sr., many of the patterns that we've seen in other figures. He also was pioneered, or I shouldn't say pioneered, he led the charge for defending world Jewry whenever he saw an opportunity to help out. For example, there's a terrible story of 250 Jews who were taken from one particular island and thrown into slavery. And this was something that happened from time to time in Jewish communities where, you know, they would be seized by pirates and then put on the slave market. Portugal was very big in the slave market. And Abravanel raced around the peninsula, gathering up a huge amount of sum to track down each one of these Jews who was sold into slavery and then ransoming them back. And for this kind of activities, he earned the respect and admiration of the entire Jewish population, who looked to him as a Moses-like figure, someone who was truly deserving of respect and adulation. Yes, question. Can I zoom in on the face a little bit?
On the words.
Not so easily. When you go online, you can do it. Let's try this here. Control plus. Yeah, sorry. Students, what are you going to do? They write down notes and stuff. He had a massive fortune. At one point, there was a loan of an astronomical amount collected from the nobility in Portugal to give to finance a particular war effort, and he himself gave more than 10% of it, just from his personal coffers, rather remarkable amount. He had a happy family life, fathered three sons, who followed in his path and who achieved fame on their own in many other fields, as well as Jewish leadership. And he maintained in touch with them even when the family was atomized by the Spanish expulsion, and managed to reunite with them towards the end of his life. But as you can imagine, this was short-lived. That's kind of like his trajectory upward, and he's active as a political and as a communal figure, a very serious success as an economic figure. But his patron, Alfonso V, died of plague, which was devastating the Iberian Peninsula at this time. He was 49 years old. It was completely unexpected. And this changed Abravanel's fortunes dramatically. The successor, and this name, I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Some say it's Joao. I like to think of it as Joao, because I think I told you last week when he was born, they said, Joao, it's a boy. I can't do that joke twice. But Joao II, the successor, was not at all the same as his father. Among other things, he was very land poor. He complained once that all my father left me were the roads of Portugal, meaning no landed estates, no massive treasury, and here he's trying to build together. He's seeing that all the other kings are moving towards the direction of the absolute monarchy, you know, the l'état, c'est moi, these kinds of attitudes of the state being identical with the king, and Portugal is the ugly duckling in the background. So one of the ways that he hoped to shore up his authority was to find some quick sources of wealth, and then distribute it in order to buy the loyalty of the nobility. The two obvious solutions were to dismantle the House of Braganza, which was a major rival for the throne, and seize their lands and then be able to distribute it to other nobles. And since Abravanel was one of the primary figures that was supported by the House of Braganza, he was definitely caught in the sights of Joao II. What happened was Abravanel was summoned to court shortly after the death of Alfonso V. He left home with a single traveling companion, and on the way, he stopped at an inn, and they learned that, in fact, the House of Braganza, the Duke, had been arrested. So Abravanel put two and two together, and he realized that he was not being called to court to get a promotion. He was, in fact, going to get something much worse. And so a very difficult decision was posed to him, and he decided that he had to flee Portugal altogether, leaving his family behind. He realized he could not simply skip across the border directly, because that would have taken him immediately past the House of Braganza itself. So he decided to move south along the coast of the peninsula, where he was undetected. And only then, after some time, he crawled across the border and made his way into Spain safely. He was declared a traitor to Portugal, as expected. All of his wealth was confiscated. Fortunately, his family was allowed to flee as well, impoverished, but nevertheless with their lives, and they made their way across the border into Spain. So he was dispossessed of all of his authority and all of his wealth in one fell swoop, and it's amazing how he was able to climb back up from that, not once, but several times, an indication of his phenomenal political prowess. His initial period in Spain was one in which he battled with, I think depression would be too hard a word, but he battled with his fate that in some ways, you know, ironically echoed that of his grandfather. In fact, there's a small ironic twist to it. Abravanel anticipated that some of his family might have been held against him for ransom. And in fact, shortly after he spirited his family out of Spain, he learned of a plot to kidnap his one-year-old grandson and forcibly baptize him, thus claiming he was a Christian and would have to remain in Portugal, and then Abravanel would be forced to come back and meet the new king. But he was nevertheless able to spirit all of his family out before that happened. And he poured his energy into his writing, something which he had done a little bit of earlier. He'd written a couple of small treatises on a number of topics. But once he came to Spain and dispossessed of all of his lands and his authority, he wrote a commentary in the first three books of Tanakh, the first post-Chumash books of Tanakh, the biblical books of Joshua, Judges, and Samuel. And it was an incredibly prolific output and created a classic work, which is still studied to this day. He wrote the equivalent of 400,000 words in 4.5 months. And for those of you who have not written novels or anything, to put it in times of space, your typical novel is somewhere between 50 and 75,000 words in length. The book that I published a couple of months ago is about 300 pages long, and it comes in at 69,000 words. So that means that this book that I worked on since like 1994, he wrote six of them in 6 months. Just an incredible output and genius, fantastic research into the language and meaning. And what else is fascinating about it is because he writes with an unusual sense of self, in which he went in the Book of Kings, for example, which is not in his initial output, but his commentary in the Book of Kings, he says things like, yeah, this is exactly the way it was when I lived in Lisbon, and the kings were just like it was over here. And he explains the Book of Kings, talking about Solomon and the rebellions and so on. He's saying he gives examples from things that he personally witnessed in the royal court. So his perspective is hardly academic. It's more like a memoir. If you could imagine something like, Lieberman, Senator Lieberman, writing not only a book about Shabbos, but a learned book, a commentary on something in the Bible, and saying, yeah, this is just like with Al Gore and Bill Clinton. We had this problem with that's sort of what this is like. It's an unusual combination of commentary in the Bible and political memoir. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant, and very gripping reading. He has a lot to say about the expulsion and so on. Of course, given his unique talents and his reputation, he was summoned to King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella, And he was allowed to retain his Jewish identity, of course, regardless of his grandfather's earlier conversion. And he entered service in their court. So now he's in his second royal court, where he was essentially the third in command economically. The king and queen were jointly the head of the government, and Abraham Senior was the principal tax collector. He was third. He worked directly under the much older Abraham Senior, and he rose to tremendous prominence in Spain after having been in tremendous prominence in Italy. But, in Portugal. As we discussed, that was short-lived. We're talking about basically the period from 1483 to 1492, which is the day of the expulsion. 9 odd years was the period of his rise to power in Spain. Amazingly, Abravanel and the other Jews of Spain did not anticipate the expulsion. Netanyahu writes about this at great length. How is it possible? A lot of it has to do with Ferdinand's own poker face. He is, in fact, I didn't know this, but when Machiavelli wrote The Prince, Ferdinand was his model. That was exactly the person he was writing about. And Ferdinand was able to keep his counsel to himself. He was famous, apparently, or infamous for, you know, listening to people without betraying any emotion about what he actually planned to do. And in fact, the Jewish community was completely caught off guard by the writ of expulsion. Abravanel attempted to stay the expulsion. It was just released in March, and it was supposed to take effect in July. And we were talking about a ridiculously short period of time to expel several hundred thousand people from the peninsula. Abravanel raised a massive bribe, offering it to the king and queen, hoping that that would stay the decision. It did not, unfortunately. There's one famous scene which, unfortunately, Abravanel did not write about. We don't have his own words, but we do have some third-person accounts in which they believed that Ferdinand was the principal mover behind the expulsion, that they felt that if they could appeal appropriately to Ferdinand, then he would rescind it. But at a key moment, he said, "Listen, why are you talking to me? You should be speaking to the Queen Isabella." And they saw an opening. They saw, oh, so perhaps it's not Ferdinand. All we have to do is speak to the Queen. The Queen owed a lot to Abraham Senior. He was apparently very much involved in setting up the original marriage, and they thought that they had an in with the Queen. And so Abravanel and Senior went in to make their last appeal to the Queen. The Queen, however, was of a single mind with Ferdinand, and she famously responded by quoting verses from the Bible, which are ironically quoted in the same context in the Talmud, that to the effect that the thoughts that the king has are planted there by God, that only God can really inspire a king to act. And Abravanel, rather than begging, according to the accounts we have, he realized that it was hopeless. So he raised himself up to full stature, and he just blasted Isabella with a withering rebuke, saying that this would ultimately be the end of Spain, that any nation that dares to persecute the Jews ultimately finds doom redound upon their own head. And he walked out with his dignity intact, at the very least. Unfortunately, that didn't help. The expulsion writ went ahead, but nevertheless, he did. You know, it's a famous oration that we only have in third-hand accounts, but nevertheless quite moving. Unlike Senior and his son-in-law and their family, who chose to convert to Christianity to retain and ultimately retain their position and authority and wealth, Abravanel chose to go into exile with the Jews, even though Isabella and Ferdinand did beg him to stay and to continue in his economic capacity, as he did Rabbi Senior. So this began a period of tremendous wandering that took him to the end of his life. He's already now in his 60s and 70s. He left Spain, and although many Jews chose to take the short route either to North Africa or to Navarre and crossing the Pyrenees into Europe proper, later we're going to have massive communities of Sephardim in Amsterdam, for example, he chose the less popular route. It doesn't quite show as well on this map because there's so many arrows here. But he ultimately decided to come to Naples in Italy. And many other Jews that we'll discuss in the next semester made their way to Muslim countries, Ottoman Turkey. He had some hesitation about going to a Muslim country, and so he and his family made their way originally to Naples. Naples didn't work out that well. They were fortunate to be accepted. There are three ships that the Abravanels were on, one of them, and the Jews on the ships contracted the plague. And so in Naples, there was a tremendous hesitation. Oh my gosh, accepting immigrants, refugees. Many of the other ports would not accept Jews at all. To even think of accepting Jews with the plague was exceptional. Nevertheless, they were moved by the plight of these beleaguered Jews, and they did in fact accept them and ultimately cared for them in Naples. And when he was there in Naples, he resumed his biblical commentary, continued it through many of the other books that we have. War, however, interrupted his stay there. He ended up having to flee first to Sicily, then later to Palermo, and then finally to Corfu and Monopoli. Wandering for many years, spending sometimes only a few weeks or a few months as war progressed and closed off many avenues for them. He began to expand his writings beyond biblical commentary, writing on the ritual of the Paschal Lamb, the Paschal Sacrifice. It comes down to us as a commentary on the Haggadah, and a series of works on the nature of prophecy and messianism in our times. And at this point, under the influence of one of his sons in particular, he was very taken with the Kabbalistic trend that we spoke about with Ibn Gabriel and others, and he began to try to use his knowledge of the Torah to calculate the messianic end, which he believed would occur in 1503. As I mentioned earlier, ultimately he was saddened and mistaken. His last major stop was in Venice, where he actually, yes, Mr. Wright. Yeah, definitely. You still have illegal communities. You still have isolated coastal communities. I mean, Hong Kong was part of China and part of England at the same time. So there's many, many exceptional rules. And Mirfred Kanshila is off a map. You know, you can't really ask questions off something as rough as this. But Jews were, in fact, migrating to these places. The whole story of the Sephardic community in London is particularly fascinating. We'll explore that, though, in the spring semester. Okay. So, weiter. Here we are, Venice. Last stop was Venice. And I think this is one of the most ironic aspects of his stay here. Remember, we have to understand that at this point, this is a man who is already into his seventh decade, has been wandering for much of the last two decades, has seen himself rise to power and been thrown down to the depths several times, running for his life, separated from his family for years at a time. Many other details I haven't shared with you, but like, for example, he wrote an entire commentary in the book of Devarim, and then he lost it in his migrations. And then he was very fortunate that he found a copy many years later that he had given to one of his sons, so he rescued it, and in fact we have the rescued copy today. But, you know, incredible stresses of this phenomenal individual. How does he manage it? At Venice, towards the end of his life, he actually rises once again into the service of a king. Specifically, the issue there, and it really fascinating that he would be associated with Portugal. Here's the situation. These two maps here show the Silk Road and the Spice Route. You have tremendous wealth of natural resources. Spices are especially valuable because you can, you know, this is before refrigeration. Spices are necessary to keep meat longer and so on. Silk is primarily produced in Turkey and in points east, China and elsewhere. Closely guarded secrets how it's produced, but it's a highly valuable luxury commodity that's very easy to transport, very light, and has a tremendous return on investment. So you've got India is packed with wealth, China is packed with this kind of wealth that Europeans way up here just love. They want that stuff, spices, silk, and so on. Hence the name Spice and Silk Road. But the thing is, there are only two routes. There is the overland route that takes you across the Himalayas into Baghdad, and then out here from, let's say, Lebanon, Syria. And then Venice was one of the Mediterranean ports that controlled the trade. Or you could go the maritime route, which essentially took you through Arabic lands and then up here to Egypt. There's no Suez Canal at this point, so then it has to go overland, either above the Sahara Desert or once again into the Mediterranean Basin. And one of the most important things about the economics of the Silk Route and the Spice Route is that every time you stop the caravan, you got to pay some taxes. Every place you stop, there's a toll. Every place you go, you got to pay for the local security to keep away the brigands. It's an expensive venture. And like you might buy a bolt of silk for, let's say, a dollar in China, by the time you finish paying taxes on it, you've got to sell it for $500 in France. It just expands in price so much. So the goal is to try and find a way to get from India to Europe without paying taxes and tolls at every rest stop. It's kind of like traveling with little kids. You know, you want them to sleep as long as possible so you don't have to stop at every single gas station. Maybe that's not the best metaphor, but let's go on. So this is what happened in this time. Vasco da Gama, you'll recall we spoke a few weeks ago about Abraham Zacuto and his development of the astrolabe and his development of the Alfonsine tables that allowed Vasco da Gama to make this tremendous trip. He, and this put Portugal suddenly way forward, and their economics boomed as a result. Vasco da Gama found a way to get around the coast of South Africa, primarily through using a lot of the shifting wind patterns. This is a really dangerous turnaround here. And then it took him a while, back and forth, but eventually got to southern India without having to make all of those toll stops. And so this maritime route to India, which was relatively easy for Portugal to dominate for at least the first half century, suddenly gave Portugal a chance to make a phenomenal amount of money in the international silk and spice trade. And this made Venice overnight irrelevant. It's like trying to sell, VHS machines in the era of Netflix. It just, VHS is all over. In fact, for those of you on the internet who were born in, let's say, 1990, VHS is kind of like a, sort of like a digital recorder that wasn't digital. I don't know why I bother telling people things like that. But anyway, so Venice was freaking out when Abravanel landed there, and they didn't know what to do about it. So Abravanel, amazingly, he came up with a plan. And he suggested it to the king of Venice, saying, hey, I have an idea of how we can negotiate an effective trade deal with Portugal. You'll have to take a bit of a loss because they really have the advantage. But on the other hand, you have the local trade network already built into Europe. And if you make a partnership with them and sacrifice some of your profits, you'll be able to stave off economic disaster. The kings and nobles of Venice heard this elderly patriarch, long flowing beard, apparently very tall individual with a booming voice, very eloquent, and they thought his plan was fantastic. And they elevated him and said, okay, you will be our prime negotiator to go back to Portugal. If you can imagine it, Portugal, that originally he's exiled, he's under a death penalty in Portugal. You can go back to Portugal as our emissary to negotiate this deal. Unfortunately, Portugal said, we're not even interested in learning about this deal because we're going to keep all the money for ourselves. We'll make our own trade deal. Thank you very much. And Venice was not able to pursue that route. But nevertheless, you get a sense for what kind of individual this must have been. This is the third set of kings that he has served and risen to the very top by dint of his own personality and intelligence. So when we think about Abravanel as a whole, And we have just touched on the political contours of his life with a little bit of a sense of what he has written. The true brilliance of Abravanel is in his writings, where you see the combination of his political insight, his depth of experience, and his intellectual acuity really come to the fore. His writing is very crisp and sharp. I find it slightly loquacious, largely because he has a lot to say, but it is an absolutely fascinating exercise to go through his work. This particular edition, which is the edition I own, has a real advantage in that it has shoulder notes, meaning, you know, you have, rather than trying to go through pages and pages of text, there are little shoulder notes that give you a hint as to, okay, now he's going to talk about this topic, now he's going to talk about this topic. It's much easier to zero in on much more on specific points. But nevertheless, this is an individual who in many ways encapsulates and typifies the unique Sephardic Jew, someone who is tremendously skilled in a wide variety of academic disciplines, is completely at home in a non-Jewish environment, and is able to negotiate with kings without embarrassment or fear, and at the same time, absolutely true to the tradition and presenting a broad-minded view of Judaism that is compelling and appealing even to this day.
Material. I really enjoy doing the research and learning a lot more about the life of Yitzhak Abravanel. They're fascinating and especially so interesting to see how his life contrasts with Abraham Senior's. And when they were faced with the difficult decisions associated with the Inquisition and especially the writ of expulsion, you know, how did they handle those things? But Abravanel really comes forth as such an incredible hero of phenomenal proportions. You know, I was really motivated by it and made me feel a lot better about my own peregrinations. You know, my wife and I observed that in the first 7 years of our marriage, we moved 10 times. And that was solely for the sake of, you know, pursuing higher education. And it was in 5 different countries and several different continents. And, you know, we could do it because we were young and we had the energy, and it was all for good things. But for Abravanel, to be able to, you know, put out such tremendous amount of material under such incredibly difficult circumstances, all I can say is really motivating for me that I've got to finish my next project really fast because I have so many things I want to write. Anyways, so Good and Welfare. Oh, one more thing. I also, you know, I'm just reflecting to myself. What I take away from this particular lecture is the incredible parallels with Nazi Germany in 1930s. And I mean, I never took that seriously, but, you know, I think Professor Netanyahu and Professor Hilberg really have a case to make there. And if you haven't seen the lecture on Abraham Senior, please go back and watch that because you'll see how I present the initial part of that argument. And then today, of course, at the beginning, we discussed how Netanyahu approaches it. Maybe it's something we'll explore in greater detail in a future lecture series. At any rate, this is the week of Hanukkah. The first lighting is tonight as I'm making this recording. If you have yet to choose Hanukkah presents for your loved ones, may I suggest my new book, which is right here on the... No, I got it wrong. Here it is. I enjoyed writing this book. I think it's a very meaningful one, and it gives people a chance. Here's a picture of me on the back cover and stuff. It gives people a chance to learn about the tremendous activity of the Piasechna Rebbe, something very dear to my heart, and I hope to do some ongoing projects in this. And otherwise, I really hope you have a fantastic holiday. We're going to take next week off in order to be able to enjoy the holiday, and then we'll return on December 25th with a final lecture for the fall season. Thank you very much for joining me as always.